Hello and welcome at Asia Auto Ambassador. We wanted to present two things to you. A, the typical German winter wonderland weather, which doesn't happen. It's raining cats and dogs outside, so we decided to go into a parking garage. And the second thing I want to present to you is still here. This is the Suzuki Swift, and I want to find out if it's still a competitive car in the Super Mini class. The Suzuki Swift is a global car. It's manufactured and sold in many places all over the world, Japan, India, and other territories. This is the European spec Swift that is built in Hungary. The sixth generation of this super mini car is on the market here since 2017. There was an update, a mild facelift in the meantime, but it's still competing against even more modern rivals such as the Hyundai i20, Volkswagen Polo, Seat Ibiza, and so on. The Swift here in Europe is available with two different engines. There's the sport top model that carries a 1.4-liter turbocharged four-cylinder mild hybrid engine with 129 horsepower. The other alternative is here. It's a 1.2-liter four-cylinder engine with no turbocharger, and that brings up to 83 horsepower, and that is a 12-volt mild hybrid with an integrated starter generator that delivers a tiny electric boost. The sixth generation Swift shows an evolutionary design. In my opinion, you can recognize at least these last three generations of the Suzuki Swift as a Swift, as they carry the large grille and more or less the same design of the headlamps, as well as the position of the A-pillars. And the car still looks fresh. It looks small and compact. In my opinion, this is a design the Mini, the BMW Mini, should carry, that grows and grows, and it's far too big in my eyes these days. The Swift is still below 4 meters in length. It's 3 meters and 85 centimeters in length, and comes as a 5-door hatch. There's no 3-door version available anymore. The door handles of the rear doors are hidden a little bit here in the C-pillar. So here's the black plastic door handle, and we will open that later on, of course. Let's have a look at the rear of the car. Well, there's again no surprise in design. Here's the hybrid lettering, but still, as I mentioned, it's a mild hybrid, not a true hybrid car. You can open the tailgate by, well, making your fingers dirty because you have to push a button here, and that's an area where all the dirt from the street comes to the car. And the boot itself measures 265 liters, which is quite good compared to many competitors, and there is no additional floor. That means that you have to, whatever you have, like heavy luggage, heavy suitcase, for example, you have to carry it here into the boot. And now we will have a look inside the car. My height is 1 meter and 92 centimeters. That's 6 feet and 3 inches, by the way. So I'm not the average guy in terms of my height, but still I have adjusted the driver's seat into my seating position so that I can compare all the cars I'm able to test. And I can, well, I hardly fit behind my imaginary self. Yeah, it's okay for short distance routes, but not for longer travels. The Suzuki Ignis, which is a little bit smaller from the outside, offers a bit more space for the legs and knees here in this second row. However, if you are Well, let's say the driver is a maximum of 1.80 meters, then it's enough space here as well. There's enough space for the feet underneath the seat, and the seats themselves, the bench is quite comfortable. I like the fabric upholstery. I like the comfort. The headrest is high enough, and there is, yeah, it's almost enough headroom for people of my size. But yeah, it's also compared to other super minis, it's quite okay here in the second row. There's a storage compartment at the back side of the backrest of the passenger seat. No air vents or USB or 12 volt power outlets, unfortunately. Also, there's no armrest. And in the door panel, you see a lot of hard plastics. That's, yeah, typical, the pragmatic Japanese way, I would say. It's all well finished, but yeah, doesn't win a beauty contest. But, well, I guess it's better if it's well finished, and that it is. We have a electrically window here, also in the second row. That's part of the Comfort Plus, called top spec trim level in Germany or in Europe, and a small cup or bottle holder here in the door. Yeah, that's pretty much it here from the rear seat department. Let's have a look into the cockpit. The driver's position is quite comfortable. This seat is large or big enough and gives a lot of comfort. It's adjustable in a manual way. The same for the steering wheel, in both ways adjustable manually to find a good seating position. The cockpit shows analog instruments. They remind a little bit on Suzuki motorcycles. We've got the rev meter on the left side and the speedometer on the right side. And in between, there's a digital display for the trip computer. And here we see the current energy status of the hybrid system and the driving assistant. So here in the test car, we have lane keeping assist and the adaptive cruise control that holds the current speed as well as the distance to the car in front of you. With a button here in the multifunction steering wheel, I can adjust what I see here, for example, the average fuel consumption, current fuel consumption, current time, torque and power if needed, and so on. So that's all adjustable here. In the higher spec versions, well, of course, specs vary from market to market, so I keep that quite general in this English language video. We have a touchscreen display here for the sat-nav, for example, and then you can change the map here, for example, the home button, you go back to the home menu, radio, telephone, and sat-nav. You can connect your smartphone by Bluetooth or via the USB socket here, and then you can use Android Auto or Apple CarPlay. And this means that, in my opinion, I would rather not need a trim level with an integrated sat-nav, because whether you use Google Maps or Apple Maps or whatever, that's the better and more accurate sat-nav, of course, when you connect your smartphone. Here the air condition, there's a manual or an automatic air condition. Here's the automatic one, is easily controllable. Here we've got the air vents and the temperature, and underneath of the air condition controls, we've got the USB and aux socket as well as a 12 volt power socket. There's no chance to charge your mobile phone wirelessly. That shows the that the Swift is not the most, or the, not a real new car. It's on the market for a couple of years already. And here we have the gear shifter of the manual 5-speed transmission. There's a button to start the engine in this trim level, combined with the keyless entry system, and I will press or push that button now and start my test drive. The 1.2-liter four-cylinder engine is not the most dynamic one. It delivers enough power for your daily driving, the manual transmission is not ideal in this second or first and second gear. You have to immediately shift from the first to the second. That is quite slow at traffic lights, for example. And this also brings me to the opinion that I would rather opt for the CVT automatic transmission. However, the car is quite fuel efficient. 6.6 liters is my consumption here, my test consumption per 100 kilometers. That is far from what the brochure promises, 4.7 liters under ideal conditions. And there are some more modern mild hybrid competitors that are even more fuel efficient in the meantime. The suspension is quite nice, the steering as well, and you always feel that the Suzuki Swift Sport that is also available is a fun to drive machine. Maybe we will do that in the near future too. And yeah, the steering gives you enough of control, and the very slim A-pillars also give you a lot of side when you turn into curves, for example. And yeah, it's a nice car for not only urban driving. Time for my resume. Well, not time for the answer to all questions, who gets that? But maybe you had questions on the Suzuki Swift and I could answer them or some of them. The car is not the most modern super mini, but it's still a nice addition to the market, especially because of its size. Below 4 meters, it does fit in all garages, parking lots, parking garages, and so on, parking spots. It's a nice compact car. It's not the most agile one, not the most dynamic one. If you are looking for more dynamics, you can opt for the Swift Sport. And here you get a reliable car that does a nice job, not only in urban driving areas, but especially in the city. My choice would be the Suzuki Swift with its CVT automatic transmission that, in my opinion, suits better to the relaxed driving behavior of the car, especially in lower gears. And this would be the ideal combination in my eyes. Let me know what you think about the Suzuki Swift, if you would still buy one if you are out there in the market for a super mini, or what your choice would be. Thank you very much for watching this video, and I hope to see you soon here on the channel. I hope that you subscribe to the channel and that you follow me also on Instagram, and this will help me to grow the whole project further. I am your Asia Auto Ambassador. My name is Bernd, and I send greetings from Germany. Bye bye.